to a foreign country, like at the University of Peshawar somewhere. It was a new breed of radicalism I came across. I remember turning up to university on my first few days, and I thought, you know, I'll go to the Islamic Society. It would be interesting.
The name of the university you went to, Penn?
Yeah, sure, Nottingham Trent University. So I went to university, and there was an event that the Islamic Society were running called How to Be a Better Muslim. I thought, I probably need that, to be honest. That would help, you know, I think I'm a good Muslim, but I'm sure I could be better. So I go to this event, we sit down, and this 20-minute video is played of violence, of dead children, of fighter jets dropping bombs, of mutilated bodies, with no narration at all. Just images which are being thrown at you on this for 20 minutes, and then the caption, "What are you doing for your brothers in Palestine?" And then the head of the Islamic Society at the time calls the video out of the way and starts talking about something completely differently. He starts talking about your induction at university. So you're getting these images, this really graphic imagery, in complete isolation, with no narration or no explanation. And as I was at university, you kind of gravitate to people who've got the same ideas as you, the same kind of political outlook. And that's exactly what I did. And it was, looking back, brutal. For example, I did politics at university, and one thing we would do is, finding a way to criticize Israel was, no matter what the subject, no matter what we were talking about, we would bring it back to Israel. We could be talking about oil drilling rights in Antarctica, we would somehow bring Israel into it. Somehow, we would find a way. And one of the things we did quite a lot, and it's shameful thinking about it now, was particularly when we had, and I had a few Jewish students who were occupiers in my lectures, we would specifically put it out there then. Almost as a, look, I'm criticizing your country. I mean, they could have been the most anti-Israel Jews going, but I'm criticizing your country. You know you can't defend it. This is a victory for us. And it was out and out intimidation. You know, they were a minority. They weren't aggressive in any way. So it was out and out intimidation. But that was, I mean, the scary thing was lecturers often joined in. You know, lecturers often joined in with demonizing Israel. But that was within the lecture theater. So, you know, there was some sort of, you could say, moderation. It was when we were outside of the lecture theater, things became even more nasty, where you would say purposely anti-Semitic comments, and you would purposely intimidate Jewish students, because, you know, you could. And you saw them as being part of the problem. And that was the thing. We knew as a group of people what we were about. We knew that we had a problem with anybody who didn't agree with us. You know, and I think one of the funniest things, looking back, I mean, not funny, but was quite sinister, was we were very active in recruiting certain types of people. Now, I mean, I've not got an image from back there, but, you know, if you really want to see a picture from my days when I had long hair and a big beard, I can send you one. But me standing outside the university with a big beard and chanting, "Death to Israel," not to be on PC, but people expect that. It's not news. You have a middle-class white guy from Oxford chanting, "Death to Israel," that's something people are interested by. And we did. We made an effort to recruit those kind of people, to befriend them, and go, look, you know, this is kind of, look what's happening, and you should take a moral stand. As a liberal, you should support Hamas. Contradiction, I know, but that's what we would do. And, you know, we're under no illusions that they weren't our friends. They served a very good purpose. You know, they made good PR. So that's something we focused on. And I was very active. You know, we would go to, it was almost an obsession. It really was an obsession. I'd go to these Al-Quds Day rallies where, middle of Trafalgar Square, people would hold up placards going, Zionism is cancer. Israel must be destroyed for the sake of world peace. People would chant death to Israel. And it happened actually a couple of months ago. We had our most recent Al-Quds Day rally in Trafalgar Square. It got to such a point, I mean, just the idealization of groups like Hamas and Hezbollah. I mean, one of the things I've always find bizarre is, looking back, you have people who say they stand up for liberal values that are waving Hezbollah flags. I mean, it makes no sense looking back. But, you know, I had a Hezbollah t-shirt, I had the full range, you know, it's, and I was quite proud of it. So that was the point I was at. And everything was focused completely on Israel. My focus had, and this is the sad thing, really. When I look back, I claim to be pro-Palestinian, but I really didn't give a damn about the Palestinians. I was more obsessed with Israel. And I found that recently with other people. I mean, I'll come back to that. How did I change? How did I go from chanting death to Israel to idolizing terrorist groups like Leslie Weber and Hamas to where I am now? It's all really happened by chance to start off with. I was in a bookshop one break, and I saw the book, The Case for Israel by Alan Dershowitz. Picked up the book and thought, oh great, Zionist propaganda, here we go again. So I purchased the book. I thought, you know, I'll read the book, prove it all to be a load of rubbish, and yeah, hey, victory for me. It was also the first time that I'd ever read anything which had even the slightest bit of pro-Israel slant to it. I'd never read, at this point, anything which would even remotely pro-Israel. I mean, I have a book called The Beginner's Guide to Israel and the Arabs, and it's got a chapter called The Jews, the Pioneers of Terrorism. And this is just a mainstream book. It's not written by any specific, you know, Middle Eastern organization or a radical organization. It's marked as just a normal history book. And there were things that I came across in The Case for Israel which I didn't know to be, you know, I'd never heard that. I didn't know that a Palestinian state has never existed. It's not anti-Palestinian to say that, it's not anti-Arab, it's just a fact. I didn't know that there's been a Jewish presence in that land for a long time, as they say, a very long time. You know, I didn't know that there were Jews from North Africa or the Arab world. I thought, you know, they were all colonialists from Europe. That was the narrative I was convinced of. So I thought, okay, this can't seem right. So some of the points, you know, I looked at and tried to research. And I was like, okay, fair enough. So I carried on doing research. I thought, you know, one book, what one book, you know, everybody has their own opinion, everyone has their own bias. So I started looking at neutral histories. I started looking at some books which were very pro-Israel, some which were very anti, and trying to find some sort of middle ground. And I think what also struck me was this parallel between Pakistan, the country my family is from, and Israel. I mean, my family are very pro, well, obviously pro-Pakistani, and a lot of, so we're a family which has served in the military from independence. And the parallels were there, you know, this minority wanting to live in safety and security in their own independent state. Didn't have the historical kind of past in that land. You could say the Jewish people of Israel, but you know, there were these parallels that were there. So, okay, fair enough. And also, you know, in my eyes and everything I'd read, Zionism was this evil ideology akin to Nazism. You know, it was just one and the same. So as I carried on reading different books, Martin Gilbert's The History of Israel, books by Noam Chomsky, I kind of came to this conclusion that maybe my hatred, my vitriol, we've got something wrong here. You know, there's something we've really missed out. We've got something badly wrong. So I spoke to some of my friends, and I love guys. Maybe maybe we've got it wrong. Maybe we're, you know, maybe this hatred stuff isn't right. And I'd get the same response. It was this, look, brother. We all called each other brother. It was very, very strange. Seeing as a lot of us didn't like each other, but that's another thing altogether. Look, that's what the Jews want you to think. Stop reading the propaganda and don't drink Coke. So I thought, okay. Alright, 50% good advice, I guess. So this starts to become a divide. You know, you start to back off from these guys because you think you're banging your head against a brick wall. You're trying to have a rational conversation, they don't want to hear it, so you kind of drift away. And there was this kind of wedge which developed. And I was just really uncertain. Here I've gone for what I believe to be cast iron truths, and a lot of it isn't. They're lies, and it plays on your mind because nobody wants to go, okay, maybe I was wrong. It's not an easy thing to do, and eventually I ended up dropping out of university and becoming quite depressed for a number of months. I mean, but once that kind of passed, I thought, okay, look, the only way I'm going to find what I'm looking for or what I'm trying to figure out is if I just go to Israel. I'll go to Israel, see what it's like. I'll have some idea of, you know, what was I thinking? Was it right or was I wrong? So I book a flight with El Al, fly from Heathrow Airport to Ben Gurion. I land at Ben Gurion Airport and spend 8 hours in security. Now, it was an interesting experience, twofold, actually. Firstly, and this is going to be very strange, it wasn't that bad. Completely honestly, it wasn't that bad, and I'll explain why. Firstly, this guy was so apologetic. You know, I'm very sorry, you've got to understand, in Israel, things are not that easy. We like some coffee. I mean, 8 hours, you consume a lot of coffee and a lot of chocolate that you kept providing. I know it's not popular to say this, and it's probably not politically correct. But unfortunately, at the time, I fit into the demographic which, on the whole, was hostile to Israel. And yes, 8 hours, I mean, I admire you guys for coming here for 45 minutes, but spending 8 hours with me, you know, I'm sure he didn't want to do that. And if him stopping people, maybe getting people a bit riled up, stops me getting burned up when I'm walking across the street in Jerusalem, I'm quite happy with that. Okay. And also, you know, my uncle went to India not long ago with work, and he actually beat me. He was kept there for 15 hours because he was born in Pakistan, so, you know. Regional rivalries die hard and all that. So eventually I bear in mind at this point I never actually had a real conversation with anyone Jewish. Other than trying to rile them up and, you know, the odd anti-Semitic comment, I never actually had a conversation with anyone Jewish. So that was quite interesting. Anyway, after these 8 hours, okay, that's fine. I'm released in Ben Gurion Airport with 8 hours full of coffee and 8 hours worth of sugar. So, you know, it was very strange experience and very little sleep. So I decide that, and this actually shows how bad my knowledge of Israel was at the time, because I fly into Ben Gurion and I thought I'll spend a week in Jerusalem first and then a week in Tel Aviv. I cannot speak a word of Hebrew to this day, and I had no idea how I was going to get from Ben Gurion to Jerusalem. That I had not figured out. I did eventually, well, strangely enough, there was this an Orthodox Jewish gentleman, obviously assuming he was Orthodox because he was dressed in a Hasidic garb, who was very helpful and got me on a cheroot to Jerusalem. Whether traveling in a cheroot could be deemed as helpful is another matter altogether. I get to Jerusalem eventually, and, you know, I'd love to say it was this amazing journey. I was exhausted. I went to the hotel and was fast asleep. But anyway, the next day, and at this point I'm thinking, okay, he was Jewish, he was, you know, what I would term as stereotypically Jewish. He, you know, he didn't have any problem with me, he didn't see, we had a really nice chat. So, okay, fine. So, I then decided to actually go out to Jerusalem. I think the one thing that struck me first was I was expecting these Arab-only signs on the bus stations and restaurants. People say apartheid, that's what you assume. I mean, one of my old lecturers at college was an anti-apartheid campaigner from South Africa. And we had so many arguments because she would constantly go, Israel is not an apartheid state, it's insulting to say that. You're an idiot. You don't know what you're talking about. So that's what I was looking for. And hey, firstly, and it's here. And then I'm seeing Christians and Muslims and Jews going about their everyday business. It's like, okay, this is strange. Another kind of contrast is, a few years before I went to Israel, I went on a religious pilgrimage to Saudi Arabia. It was really special for me, it was very important. I went with some members of my family, and it was a dream which turned into a bit of a nightmare. I've never experienced that much racism in my life. It was awful. My auntie, bless her, she was actually pushed out of the line at an ATM and was told that you're a Paki, you can wait. In Europe, the term Paki is a racist term. It's offensive. I don't know how it's viewed here. That had left, and just everything was so long-winded for no apparent reason. I'm quite lucky. I have, a beautiful red British passport. But people with a Pakistani passport, oh wow! Because we went as a group. They one poor chap. He was in. He was like 85, and he was made to wait at every single checkpoint. He was taken out every time, and it was just. It was awful. So here I'm in Israel, apartheid Israel. So far, so good. No problems. So I go to the old city, as you do in Jerusalem. I'm seeing just this mix of people, Muslim Arabs, Christian Arabs, Jews, and everyone's pretty much getting on with life. So it's like, okay, this is not really what I was expecting. But okay, fair enough. We'll go with it. And I got to the old city, and I did, the religious thing. I went to the Church of the Holy Sepulchre, to the Al-Aqsa Mosque, and the final stop was the Western Wall. Am I even allowed near the Western Wall? I'm not Jewish. A lot of that came from, on this trip to Saudi Arabia, one of the people in our group was manhandled out of the Prophet Muhammad, peace upon his mosque, because they said he was engaging in grave worship. Because he touched the pillar at the front of the where the Prophet's buried. So I thought, okay, I go through security at the Western Wall, he half looks at my passport, and I'm waving through it. So I thought, okay, this is strange, I don't really know what to do. do I pray? Do I rub the stones? I'm not too sure. I kind of got closer to the Western Wall, and eventually when in Rome almost, I kind of put my forehead on the Western Wall, and there was this really strange realization. I thought, okay, here I am in a democratic state, where people have equal rights, where it's the safest place for the LGBT community in the Middle East. I'm seeing Muslims, I'm seeing Christians, I'm seeing Jews, I'm seeing people going about their day-to-day lives. But at the same time, I'm in a Jewish state. I've got the flag of Israel flying behind me with the Star of David on it. And then that's kind of when it hit me. I thought, okay, no matter what happens from this point on, no matter what political settlements are decided, no matter what outcomes happen in this region, there are 6 million people who won't make it to this point, no matter what. No matter what happens from this day on, there are 6 million people who died with that next year in Jerusalem. And it made it very real. It took it away from this political aspect. It was almost, this isn't about politics. And almost sadly, looking at it now, it's about survival.
I can't listen to any more of this. I want to get out of here.